abusive Hedda Nussbaum 18 years ago in a crime that shocked America. Her live-in lover, Joel Steinberg, beat her brutally and killed their adopted daughter. Now he's a free man, and she's here for her first interview since he got out of prison. First, another exclusive, the family of the groom who...
Abuse. She's written a book called Surviving Intimate Terrorism. This is her first appearance since her former lover got out of jail. He murdered their adopted daughter. Don't go away.
American Morning.
This is a haunting face, a mask of suffering, a courtroom exhibit of the years of violence that disfigured a once pretty woman. Hedda Nussbaum may be a victim, but she is not the victim. This trial is about the murder of a little girl, Lisa Steinberg, age 6, the illegally adopted daughter of Nussbaum and Joel Steinberg, who died of abuse and neglect last year. The two were arrested together, but Steinberg faces a charge of second-degree murder alone. Calling her a zombie, battered beyond will, the prosecutors cleared Nussbaum and made her their star witness. She testified that Steinberg would beat Lisa and that she would do nothing about it.
Joel Steinberg was convicted of manslaughter in 1988 after a trial that lasted many days with chilling testimony by our guest, Hedda Nussbaum. Joel was given a sentence of 8 1/3 to 25 years. He was paroled at the end of June of 2004, spending 17 years behind bars. Hedda has written a book, Surviving Intimate Terrorism. There you see its cover, and this is her first interview since her abusive live-in lover, Joel Steinberg, was released. Hedda was last on this show in June of 2003. At the time of that interview, he was still in prison. What are the conditions, Hedda, of his release? He can't contact you?
He's not allowed to have any contact with me, or I believe the families of our other child, and Lisa's birth mother also.
Where's the other child?
He was returned to his birth mother.
Okay. And you are not living in... He's in New York. He can't leave New York.
He's not allowed to leave New York, and he's not... apparently, he cannot leave without getting permission from his parole officer, yes.
And are you in a place you don't reveal?
Yes, I moved from New York a year and a half ago, and I am not letting people know where I'm living.
Because
and I
of
don't
fear?
Want anything to be known about my current life.
You don't want to know if you're married, not married, what you're doing, etc.
Correct.
Because of?
Well, because I do not want him to know, find out, and I don't want the press to find out, and then eventually everybody will know where I am.
But you have fear, right? Well, you don't want to be bothered.
Well, a little of each.
But you wrote a book.
Yes, I wrote a book because I felt that I wanted to get this story out, and I believed that it would help a lot of women. Because I used to go around giving talks at colleges and to women's groups, and people told me that it helped them tremendously. So I felt that the book would really be helpful to other women.
Why go on television?
I figured that in for a penny, in for a pound, that I could get the book to more people if I went public with it. And
but also,
there is a risk, I agree.
You have neighbors, do you not, where you now live?
Yes.
Who may not know you?
Well,
who now know you?
Well, this is it. I would like to ask them that if they're seeing me now, that my neighbors, my hairdresser, women I work out with at the gym, do not run to the telephone and say, guess what? Because I would like to keep it confidential. I am living under a different name in mm-hmm. a different state.
Okay. Do you believe, as you knew him,
yes,
that if he could get to you, he would harm you?
I don't know. I really don't know. I don't know what his state of mind is these days. It's been a long time.
All right. Surviving intimate terrorism, the obvious question is, why'd you put up with it? It's never that never easy to answer, I guess. The first time he hit you, why didn't you go out?
Because he did not, well, in general, men who batter don't hit the woman until they have control over her. And the way control first. And the way he got control, it was 3 years I'd been with him. The way he got control was to, I was very shy in those days, and he helped build me up and helped to bring me out.
So
I thought he was, but he acted, he used to work with me evenings almost like a therapist and helped me to come out of my shell.
Was he good at it?
He was good at it, it worked. And he used to push me to ask, I was working for Random House. I
started, book editor, right?
Yes, I started as an associate editor. He kept asking me, pushing me to ask for raises and then promotions, and I went from associate to editor to senior editor. And of course, I realized that they wouldn't have given me raises and promotions unless I deserved it, but then I didn't see it that way. I believed that I gave him all the credit for everything, and so I had him on a pedestal.
Yeah.
And the first time he hit me, I figured, oh, it was just a fluke, it would never happen again. But of course, it did happen.
Now, tell me how the two children came to live with you.
Well, Joel did, as part of his legal practice, he was a lawyer, he did some private adoptions. And these were both done that way.
Although they were
never official adopted.
Did
they
he
were
ever
never
bother
completed.
The boy?
No, absolutely not.
Only the girl?
Yes.
We'll pick it up in a minute. The book, Extraordinary, it's Surviving Intimate Terrorism. No one knows it better than Hedda Nussbaum. We'll also be including your phone calls. We'll be right back.
Accused child murderer Joel Steinberg heard testimony from former lover Hedda Nussbaum, which for the first time directly linked him to violence against 6-year-old Lisa Steinberg the night she fell into a coma.
One thing he said was about Lisa, I knocked her down and she didn't want to get up again. This staring business had gotten to be too much for her.
Nussbaum said Steinberg believes she and Lisa often hypnotized people by staring at them. He complained about it that night while allegedly freebasing cocaine. Hedda Nussbaum resumed her testimony, describing how in the months before 6-year-old Lisa Steinberg died, she saw her lover, Joel Steinberg, strike the child.
Joel grabbed Lisa by the arms or shoulders, shook her, threw her down on the floor. And when she got up, he grabbed her, shook her again, and threw her down, and that happened at least 2 or 3 times.
She told how Joel Steinberg ordered her to dress Lisa in long-sleeved clothes to cover up bruises.
The unbelievable story, it's all in her own words, in Surviving Intimate Terrorism, a book the feminist icon Gloria Steinem calls a brave book. What was the hardest part of writing it?
Well, the hardest part actually was trying to reproduce Joel Steinberg's words, because, which I realized later, had so much power in them. He used to sit and talk to me. He'd go on and on for hours, and I was fascinated with him. But in a sense, those words were brainwashing words and manipulative words. And I wanted to get some sense of those words in the book, and I just couldn't write more than a half a sentence.
Why only manslaughter? Why only 17 years?
Well, they believe that there was a compromise of the jury, because some people
wanted him not guilty.
Some people wanted him not guilty. Some people were convinced that I had done it.
Really?
And yes.
What led that thinking to occur?
Well, a large part of his defense was that I had done it.
I see. Did he take the stand?
No, he did not.
So they think the jury compromised and went for manslaughter rather than second.
Apparently, yeah.
Second degree murder. What did she die of?
I know what it was, but
Battering?
From battering, from a brain injury.
Were you from a dysfunctional family?
No, not at all. I had very loving parents. In fact, I was overprotected. And I think because I was overprotected, I was very trusting and vulnerable to somebody who was like that.
Did your parents know Joel?
Oh, yes, they loved him. They thought he was terrific.
Did they know what was happening to you?
No, no, I did not let them know.
When did they discover this?
I'm not sure, because he isolated me from my whole family. For several years, I didn't see them. And from all my friends, this is typical of abusive abusers do that. So that they won't, so that the woman won't go and tell them, you know, what's happening. And of course, at a certain point, I didn't want them to see me once I had injuries that were apparent. I didn't want them to see me.
What was it like to testify?
Well, the only thing I wanted, so that I would have confidence, I made sure that I did not look at Joel during the when I testified. I made sure that the bunk, you know, the judge's bunk, blocked my view of him.
You didn't want to look at him.
I did not want to look at him.
You're still afraid of him.
I guess I was, yes.
He committed infidelity, did he not?
Yes.
Why didn't that end it? He admitted it to you, right?
He admitted it to me. In fact, see, I thought that he blamed his infidelity on me, that I wasn't giving him what he needed. And I felt that, well, at least he's not doing this behind my back. He's coming and telling me.
Boy, you were a glutton.
I wasn't a glutton. I had been manipulated. I had been what I call brainwashed, really. I believe that little by little by little, I started losing myself. And it happened so gradually that I wasn't aware of it.
How did you recover?
I was in psychiatric hospitals for a year and a half. And I had a lot of support. My family, even though I had been isolated from them for years, they were right there for me immediately. A lot of my old friends came back, and I had support. I had a lot of support of a lot of women around the country as
well. How old is the boy now?
He's 19 now.
You hear from him?
No. I've never had, they have never wanted him to have any contact.
How long is he with you?
He was 16 months old. And I had him from the time he was a day old.
So 16 months.
Till 16 months, yes. So he was like my own baby.
Yeah, obviously he was. You miss the little girl?
Do I? Mm-hmm. Oh, of course. I miss both of them. It was very difficult for me to get over losing both my children.
Did Joel have any remorse?
Apparently not, and that's why he was never released on parole. Because the parole board felt he never had any more. He never admitted to having done anything.
He did 70 months with time off then.
17 years.
17 years with time off.
Time off for good behavior, yes.
We'll be right back, and when we come back, we'll be including your phone calls for Hedda Nussbaum. The story is Surviving Intimate Terrorism. A great title. Tough lady. Don't go away.
Getting high cholesterol down is important.
The 911 call you made before we go to calls, the book is Surviving Intimate Terrorism. The author is Hedda Nussbaum. Was that when you found your daughter?
No. First, Joel, when I wanted to call 911, he said, no, first give me a chance to try and revive her. So he did that, and when he finally felt that he couldn't, because I think he panicked finally when he saw that she seemed to have stopped breathing.
He said,
call 911. I waited for him to tell me, though, to say, do it.
That's how controlled you were.
That's how controlled I was.
And let's listen to that call.
Was she eating something? I'm just trying to find out why she would stop breathing.
West 175th Street. They'll be there soon.
I think, well, I don't really know exactly why.
You really don't know? Okay.
Food's covering up. She's throwing up a lot of food and water. My daughter's suggested that she should stop breathing.
Okay, she's having difficulty breathing?
She's not breathing. She's getting her mouth to mouth.
Okay, 6-year-old there. Okay, I'm going to connect you to the ambulance.
They got there real fast?
Yes, they did.
Let's take some calls for Hedda Nussbaum, Augusta, Kentucky. Hello.
Hello. Love your show, Larry.
Thank you.
Hedda, where's your book located at? Where can I get it?
You can get it online, Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com, and probably in many bookstores. You can always order it if they don't have it in stock.
But Amazon certainly has it.
Amazon certainly has it, yes.
Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Hello.
Hi. I was just wondering if I could ask you a question that's a little bit brazen. I empathize with your situation and have followed it for almost 20 years. And I'm just curious, you look really, really good. And I've wondered if you've had some reconstructive surgery since, and I hope you found some peace.
Well, thank you. Yes, I had reconstructive surgery several times, yes.
Out of necessity, right?
Out of necessity, yes.
How did you get over it? What did they do in the psychiatric clinic and all your visits that helped? How did you beat this problem?
There's not a simple answer that I can give you. I was in a wonderful hospital called Four Winds Hospital in Katona, New York. And that at the time I was there, they had a program. It was like going to college. You'd go to different therapy groups. You had a schedule, and plus individual therapy. And it was just wonderful. And it just took time. And the day my eyes opened, and suddenly I saw Joel Steinberg for who he really was. Mm.
So, when you were testifying, you were given immunity, right?
No, I was, well.
They didn't charge you.
They had dropped the charges before I testified, yes, because the district attorneys believed my story and that I was incapable of having done it.
When you were testifying, were you still in love with him?
No, I wasn't still in love with him. I felt that I was still in love with him for about 10 months after...
The child died?
Yes, because of everything that had been done to my head. But as I said, on the day my eyes opened, that I call, I suddenly saw him, and then I felt I was no longer in love with him, and it made testifying a lot easier.
What do you think when you see him now? See that picture of him?
I really don't have very many feelings at all at this point.
Empty?
Excuse me? It's kind of empty, I would say, yes. There are moments when I feel huge rage and anger, but generally it's just empty.
San Diego, hello.
Yes, hello. Larry, love your show.
Thank you.
Miss Nussbaum, I was just wondering, do you have any contact with your daughter's biological mother?
No, I've never had any contact with her at all.
That was an illegal adoption, right?
Well, it was never legalized, and I never liked the term illegal adoption, but it was never made legal. It was never completed.
She would have been 24 now, huh?
Yes, she would.
Good little girl?
Oh, she was wonderful. She was a very, very special child. Very talented, bright.
How did you deal with all the frenzy? Law and Order did an episode on this.
Yes.
How did you deal with it?
Well, I found it very difficult at first because people didn't understand domestic violence in those days, and a lot of people were blaming me. And there was a lot of horrible stuff written about me and said about me that was just totally inaccurate. And it was very painful. Until I got to a point where I realized that the people who were against me just didn't understand, and that I couldn't let it destroy me. So.
Yeah. We will, but it must have been hectically incredible.
Yes.
Photographers, television,
Everything.
Stories, newspaper, people you're following around. How did your parents react?
They had a very difficult time with it, but they decided to, they gave interviews to the press, and I think my sister had the hardest time with it. She
Younger or older?
Older. She was 2 years older than me. She is 2 years older than me. And it was very painful for her what the press was saying about me and all the attention and everything.
Parents still living?
No, both my parents have passed away.
We'll be right back with more of Hedda Nussbaum. Her book is Surviving Intimate Terrorism. Don't go away. Nussbaum, let's check in with Anderson Cooper. He'll host AC360 at the top of the hour. He's in Iraq all this week. Tonight, this morning, he's in Baqaba, Iraq. What's up, Anderson?
Hey, Larry. Yeah, we're in Bakuba, Iraq. It's about 35 miles north of Baghdad. We're on the forward operating base Warhorse. U.S. military really on the front lines in the insurgency here. This was a hotbed of insurgent activity last year. It's a real success story on the part of the U.S. and Iraqi forces. Tonight, we're going to take you out on patrol, showing you the frontline battle against these insurgents who every day are improving their tactics using IEDs, improvised explosive devices. We'll take you to the front line in the fight against the insurgency, Larry.
Thanks, Anderson. That's at the top of the hour, 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific. Anderson Cooper, arguably the best field reporter in the business. Chicago, hello.
Hello, Larry.
Hi.
Hi. I guess my question is, with all these comments about what a wonderfully courageous woman, what kind of wonderfully courageous woman would let these beatings go on to this innocent child?
Well, first of all, I never saw him hit her. What I had testified to was once I did see him shake her and throw her, but I never saw him hit her, and there weren't, as far as I know, I don't know how many beatings there were. Plus,
did you see markings on her, though? Did you?
Yeah, I believe that at that time I was basically a zombie by then. I mean, I just, my whole self was gone, was destroyed, and certainly, if I had been the me I am today, none of that would have gone on. But I wasn't able to do
anything. So you look at that as a different person?
I look at that, in a sense, as a different person, yes.
By the way, Larry King Live tried more than once to get a statement from Joel Steinberg through his attorney, Darnay Hoffman. Mr. Hoffman did not respond to our request. Has he done any interviews, to your knowledge?
Not recently.
To Schneider, Texas. Hello.
Hello, Larry.
Hi.
I was wanting to know, I was in a relationship about like yours. Why didn't you get out when the first time he hit you or the first time you found out that he was harming the kids?
Well, the first time he hit me, I believe I said this earlier in the show, I thought he had gotten me to believe that he was just such a wonderful person. He had helped build me up and pushed me to ask for raises and promotions. And I gave him all the credit and thought the first time that it was just a fluke, it would never happen again. And by the time, as I said, it was years and years of myself going downhill until he harmed a child that I was just incapable of doing anything.
Were there a lot of drugs involved in this?
There were a lot of drugs.
Yours too? You did it too?
I did it with him because he felt that it helped us communicate better.
Did what, coke?
It was coke. It was freebase cocaine, which is like homemade crack, really, is what it is. And you smoke it.
And smoked it with the little kids around?
Only when Lisa was asleep at night. We didn't. The last few weeks, Joel had gotten a kilo of cocaine from a client that he was holding, and then he started doing it during the day all the time and sending Lisa out to play with her friends.
Queens Village, New York. Hello.
Hi, Larry. You're the best. Hedda, I have a two-part question.
Yes.
Number one, did you love Lisa? And where was your mother's instincts to protect her? Thank you.
Oh, I loved Lisa very, very much. I loved both my children very much. My mother's instincts to protect her, as I said, I believe that I was not a whole person anymore. Little by little, myself had been eroded very, very slowly. And if I could go back and redo it, everything would be different. But obviously, I can't do that.
Is your life happy today?
Yes, my life.
You're not going to tell us anything about it.
I'm not going to tell you about my life today.
But are you happy?
Yes, I am. I am. Of course, I'd be happier if I had my children. But basically, yes.
We'll take a break and be back with more. The book is Surviving Intimate Terrorism. The author is Hedda Nussbaum. Don't go away.
I do not hit, strike, or use any form of forceful discipline of any sort.
Steinberg denied claims he beat Lisa because she stared at him. What's undisputed, Steinberg and Nussbaum had illegally adopted Lisa at birth. Her teachers saw bruises over time. Neighbors heard screams from their West Village brownstone, but no one investigated.
I work for...
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you, Larry, for a wonderful show.
Sure.
I wanted to ask Hedda how she has recovered from the death of her daughter. I lost a baby daughter over 50 years ago, and I still mourn her death. Does she feel, can she feel totally happy knowing that she was involved when her child was killed?
Of course I still mourn her death. She was a wonderful, loving, beautiful, sweet child. I think she was an exceptional person. And it's painful to me that she is no longer in this world.
You take blame?
I have come to realize that anything that I was unable to do was because of what Joel Steinberg did to me. And I have been able to put the blame where I believe it belongs.
What advice do you give to women who are abused? What do you say to them?
Well,
no one knows it better than you.
Well, there's one thing, and that is that they should have a safety plan, which I didn't. I attempted to leave him. I actually left five times and attempted to leave six. The first time he came home and found me, and I ended up on the floor packing. But they need a safety plan where they will have a plan where they're going to go and who they're going to go. Actually, the way I have taught it to women is the three P's: pick, pack, and photocopy. Pick someone you know you can trust that you can run to. Pack a little bag in advance with things that are necessary, like medications, a change of underwear, anything really important, and photocopy important papers like marriage license if you're married, birth certificates of children, and put them in the bag and leave it with the person you can trust so that if you have to leave any time, day or night, you know where you can go. I never knew where to go, and I always ended up coming back.
And also a lot of women stay, right?
Oh, yes, of course they do. They stay or they leave and come back. The average is five times that they leave and come back.
Usually liquor is involved, right?
I think sometimes.
I mean, that's what we come to think. The man gets drunk and he comes.
Well, that's often true, yeah.
And was Joel always high when he hit you?
No.
In fact, hit you when he was sober?
He hit me when he was sober. Most of the time he was sober.
How do you think he'd have handled prison?
I really don't know. I believe, though, that in prison that the other prisoners would not have been kind to him because of what he did to a child.
I would guess that. And now, do you know what he's doing? He's got a part-time. What's he doing?
I only know what I heard in from the press, and that is that he's working part-time and
living
in New York City.
Thank you, Hedda. The best of luck to you.
Thank
you
very much.
Thank you for coming forward. Hedda Nussbaum, the book is Surviving Intimate Terrorism. Tomorrow night.